Thank you. Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming this afternoon. My name is Tari Hum, and I'm a faculty member at Queen's College, and I'm the moderator for this afternoon's talk, which I think is titled Reflections from the Field. Is that? Or Thoughts from the Field?
Tales from the Field.
Okay. Tales from the Field. I think ever since Peter kind of convened the mapping Asian American New York group of us, Asian Americanists across different CUNY campuses, I think one of his goals was to provide a space for all of us to kind of share our research and, you know, and have an opportunity to present our work and get feedback, et cetera. So I think this is the final event of the semester, is that right? And we're finally getting an opportunity to do that. So thank you for joining us for this conversation. For this afternoon, we have four presenters, three from CUNY and Zai Liang from University at Albany, University of Albany. So I think that we'll go in the order. Can we go in the order around
reverse
here?
Reverse order.
Okay.
So do you want a conversation or do you want like each of us to speak?
Well, I guess it depends. I know for this conversation, I had circulated just a couple of questions. We could go in terms of order. And each have about 10 or 15 minutes to describe our research, what we're doing, our methods, maybe different challenges and opportunities for community-based research, some of our more kind of surprising or interesting findings or engagement or challenges of doing community-based research. I think those are some of the questions. So do we want to have more conversation or each of us having, each of you guys having a 10-minute opportunity to present? Why don't we, should we stick with that?
Okay,
great.
Sure.
So then maybe first is John Chin. John is the chair of the Urban Planning Program.
On leave, right.
Okay, of the Urban Planning Graduate Program on leave at Hunter College. Zai Liang is professor of sociology at SUNY Albany. Margaret Chin is professor of sociology at Hunter. And Peter Kwong is professor also of urban planning and affairs at Hunter College. And we'll start with John.
Okay. Well, since we're pretty small, maybe I'll talk about what I was going to say, but maybe keep it a little bit brief. So I guess I was thinking about the questions that we had posed for this seminar and thinking maybe it would help if I also talked a little bit about just my career trajectory, because that sort of explains sort of how I got where I am in the field. I am a doctorate in urban planning. That's my discipline, is urban planning, which is it's already an interdisciplinary field. But I got my doctorate at Columbia, and a lot of my mentors were sociologists. And I remember, you know, I was really open to lots of things when I went to graduate school, so I was open to anything kind of applied and policy related or urban planning related or urban related. And I remember being at a party with some of our professors and some grad students, and one of my professors says, "John, do you really want to be a professor?" And I was kind of taken aback, but I realized that in hindsight that what that was about was I didn't want to be a professor like they were professors, which were very academic, very high-level thinkers. I was much more of an applied kind of person. I wanted my work to be kind of more in the real world, I guess. And so I did feel a bit out of place at Columbia, even though I think I did okay over there. But it was sort of a clarifying moment for me, I think, in my career. Also, I have a long history of working in nonprofits. So I helped to co-found an organization called Asian Pacific Islander Coalition on HIV/AIDS, and I was on staff there for 8 years. And this actually started in 1989, and I was there from that time. So I've been involved with the organization now for 25 years. And by the time I got my first academic job, which was in 2007, I guess I had been mostly doing nonprofit work, and then grant-funded research at the New York Academy of Medicine for almost 15 to 20 years, I guess. And so when I first got my academic job, I really felt like this is not I'm not really working, right? Because I'm just writing, I'm doing some teaching, I'm doing research. And so I really felt kind of like I wasn't really working. It was very uncomfortable for me. And over the years, I really have gotten used to the fact that this is my job. You know, I'm a researcher, I'm a writer, and a teacher, and that's my job. But since Tari was asking about the difficulties of doing community-based research, one of the difficulties for me is that sometimes I want to be more involved in the service end of the community work that I'm doing. So right now I'm really very much on the research end. And so a lot of the impact I have is around developing new knowledge and hoping that knowledge will disseminate into the community work and then shape that work. But sometimes I do have the desire to be more directly involved, and so that there's kind of a tension there. So maybe just I'll tell you a little bit about what I'm working on right now. We could talk about it some more if there are questions. Most of my work has been in HIV. In grad school, I think I really wanted to move away from that. I wanted to study ethnic economies and look at Chinatown and that kind of thing. And I actually, you know, Peter was one of my professors, and he helped me do some projects in that area. But I really found it very hard to do my dissertation on that because I was working at Apicha almost full time, and I just had a hard time kind of doing two separate things. So my dissertation ended up being on New York City's HIV planning process, where they allocate, I think, almost $500 million in HIV funds. It was looking at that policy process and how the community got involved in planning for those funds. But that kind of set the path for me. And I think ever since then, I was thinking like, well, one day I'll do my real work, you know, outside of HIV and outside of health and more on, you know, what I had started with. But 20 years later, you find that you're still doing what you've been doing. And then you realize, well, maybe this is actually what I like to be doing. So the big projects I'm working on now are, I just finished a 5-year study looking at Chinese immigrant religious organizations and their views on getting involved in HIV. And so I have a 5 years worth of data I'm trying to publish off that. And then a new study looking at massage parlors, sexually oriented massage parlors in New York City and Los Angeles with my colleague Lois Takahashi at UCLA. And so I kind of joke that it's moving from the sacred to the profane, but there is kind of like, there is a common theme here, which is going to one of Tari's questions about what motivates my research is I'm very curious about sort of the underside of things. And so with religious institutions, I think of them in both positive and negative ways, that they're very good for the community, but they're also the kind of institutions that dictate, you know, what's right and what's wrong in the community, often to the detriment of certain subgroups. And so I'm very curious about, like, what are they really thinking? You know, they have these great, beautiful, peaceful spaces. People rely on them for lots of support, but what's really going on in those institutions? And then with the massage parlors, of course, like, they're popping up all over the place. There's 3 in my neighborhood. Really wondering, you know, what's going on there, especially like if illegal stuff is happening, how are they really operating? You know, what's going on there? And that maybe leads to one of my surprising findings with the massage parlors. Number one, that there's so many of them in New York. So we documented 475 sexually oriented massage parlors in the 5 boroughs of New York City. And I think we probably didn't even hit all of them. And those are the ones with the storefronts, you know, the ones you could see on the street and have a door and that kind of thing. There's much more activity that's in residential apartments and that kind of thing that we're just not seeing at all. One of the surprising things there is, I mean, that there might not be as much, this was a HIV-funded study, so there's not as much HIV risk as we might have thought. There are a lot of hand jobs. So from a health perspective, That's not that risky. There is a fringe that's doing pretty risky stuff. So we want to look more into that.
What about prophylactics?
Well, that's the thing. When they do riskier stuff, they're not necessarily using prophylaxis. So, yes, that's the problem, I think. And they get paid a lot to not use it. So there are stories of women who are saying, you know, I got offered $1,000 not to use a condom, that kind of thing. So it's hard to turn down. The other surprising thing is, you know, a lot of the things we might assume that people do this out of economic necessity and that kind of thing, it's true. But the women also develop interesting rationales for why they're doing what they're doing. And one woman told us that she thinks she's doing a community service, that some of the men she works with are quite angry and aggressive, and just think how much worse they would be if they didn't have her to go to and help relieve some of their stress. So, I mean, whether that's a rationalization to make her feel better about what she's doing or whether she really believes it, it's hard to say, but it's kind of an interesting idea. So, I don't know, maybe I'll just stop there and we'll can just have more conversation. Right. Yeah.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Sure.
My turn, right? Thank you. Yeah, so I want to thank my CUNY colleagues for having the opportunity to share my work with my colleagues here. In fact, I was part of family. I was teaching at Queens College a long time ago, in 1990s, right? Yeah. And then for about 9 years. So in 2002, actually, I moved from Queens College to SUNY Albany, the capital of New York State. So this year I'm spending 1 year at the Russell Sage Foundation in Upper East Side, so doing research. So my training is primarily in quantitative sociology and also in demography, although I'm increasingly more and more appreciative of the qualitative ethnographic type of research. So because of that, I think, initially when I first moved to New York, that was 1993, was my first year as an assistant professor at Queens College. So essentially, I was doing a little bit research on international migration in my doctoral dissertation. So, and then I was doing 2 year postdoc at Brown University from 1992 to about 1994. So in the second year of my postdoc, I got a job offer from Queens, so I came here. So, but I have something very much in my head that I wanted to, do research on the international, migrants, right? Here in New York, I think the natural starting point for me is to look for a topic that's connecting to the community, right? Chinatown, for example, right? So I was, that's what I thinking about. But then in 1993, I think it was in the spring, I think we all heard about this golden winter, episode, the tragic event that, there are a lot of people die. But so essentially that brought a major international media attention to the issue of, undocumented migrants from China's Fujian province. So from my perspective, I thought, well, maybe that I can study that topic as well, right? So I have some friends from professors in China who are from Fujian province. So I thought, well, why don't I go to Fujian and take a look at what are the community look like, right? Back in the early 1990s. So that was my starting point. But whether the kind of approach you're going to take, for your research project, I think depends on research questions. What kind of questions do you want to address? But also depends on the financial resources, right? So sometimes you have brilliant ideas, but you really can't do it until later. So I think my goal initially was pretty modest. I told myself, what can we learn from the data we have collected in China, by the Chinese government, right? Because that's sort of free from my perspective. As an assistant professor, I didn't have a lot of money. So I know the data pretty well. So we run a little bit tables. The thing is, there's limited information about international migration in the Chinese survey and census data. But the major thing, actually, we can get a pretty good idea about for example, what are the major provinces, you know, sending migrants to the, you know, other countries, mm-hmm. right? U.S., for example. So we can say, you know, Beijing, for example, Shanghai, and right, you know, Guangdong, traditionally, a major migrant sending province. And then the other thing that, looking at the data from China, over time, you can actually see pretty clearly that, you know, international migrant from Fujian, you know, went out very, very quickly. And the nice thing about using data from China was that you can actually compare, you know, the people who left versus people who remain in China, right? What are the basic characteristics? What are their occupations, you know, prior, you know, leaving for the United States, right? So marital status, you learn something about that process. I think perhaps the most important thing that I learned in that project was that there was a critical time that the major shifting from urban-based international migration to rural-based. You know, in Fujian, you can clearly see the data shows that pattern. And that transition is very important. We know that rural part is much larger, right? So if you see that trend going to the rural migrant sending places, you're going to have a big pool of potential workers to come, right? And in fact, that's clearly happened. You know, some year later, we observe that. And the other thing about rural origin is that the rural places tend to have a very dense network, right? They have much more so than the urban-based migrants. And that matters in terms of, you know, trust, right? And, you know, the money and so forth, starting business once they're in U.S. So that was sort of my initial take on the Fujian migration issue. And then I think Peter and I had a session in maybe 1995 together. So I, you know, we shared that, you know, I think in the conference in Rutgers some years ago.
That's 20 years.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
Wow.
And then I wasn't happy with what I did at that point. I said, you know, I can probably do a little more. And, you know, I was getting a little more ambitious. I said, you know, I know about the province very well. I know the literature pretty well. You know, I want to be doing a little bit bigger project, you know, larger sample in both part, you know, both China, U.S., right? So I was, you know, investigating whether that's possible, right? So I did some work, and then I wrote some proposals. So luckily, I got some funding. So I was able to carry out that idea, you know, so where you can draw a China-based migrant sending community sample. So I have maybe about 2,800 households. So we carry out that survey in 2002 or 2003 and 2004. And meanwhile, we also carry out a survey in Chinatown. So speaking about community, how do you do community kind of research in China and the U.S.? I think from China's perspective, is at least at that time, was a lot more difficult because the, you know, undocumented migrant story was not something that the Chinese government were proud of, right? So they try everything possible to make sure nobody, carry out that kind of research. So essentially, I have to work very hard with my Chinese collaborators, right? So, you know, the thing is that if you want to do, you know, go to a village, talk to some people, that's probably okay. But doing a massive survey, that's, you know, that you had to work through the system somehow, right? So we were able eventually to get it done with my collaborator. I remember, I think maybe earlier conference, some people say you can't really do a survey of that magnitude in China, right, on this topic, because that's just, you know, too sensitive. Mm-hmm. But eventually we were able to do it. Now, back in New York, I think the survey we did was, we talked about 410 immigrants from Fuzhou. So essentially, we were working closely with the Fujian American Association in East Broadway. Mm-hmm. So they were very, very helpful. So essentially what we did was we rented an office. So I had some money from the project to pay the rent. Mm-hmm. So we set up an office. I have these Fujian speaking students work with me. They carry out their interviews. And the timing was a little bit fortunate from my perspective, because that was after 9/11, some of them are unemployed, so they have some time to talk. Plus, I offer a little bit of financial incentives for interviews. So that was I finished that part, and then the third project, which I'm sort of doing right now was starting about 2010. The project started about 2010. So essentially look at how the immigrant from Fujian province, you know, came to New York and then actually moved to other places. And the idea came from actually the earlier project. You know, when I did the major survey in the Chinatown in 2003-2004, well, I look at their labor history to see what kind of jobs, you know, they got. So my perception was that, you know, they're going to tell me that they have jobs in, you know, Manhattan, they have jobs in Brooklyn. You know, in any case, probably the job history shows the New York-based story. But to my surprise, when you look at their history, I have a long questionnaire, and majority of job history actually not in New York. In fact, all about other places. And I said, well, this is actually interesting because all the books we read about Chinatown, right? So all the researchers think about study pretty much have a conception about, you know, immigrant based in one location, right? You know, New York City and Los Angeles, San Francisco, not quite thinking beyond that, right? And the Fuzhou story is interesting because really thinking we have to rethink about what happened to that story. So I thought maybe something that I can do. So I wrote a proposal to the Resuscitation Foundation, you know, idea to sort of track down on some of the stories. And so in that process, we carried out a survey of employment agencies in Chinatown. We surveyed about 13 employment agencies in Chinatown. I think Ken probably knows. I read that. So from that survey, we essentially tabulate every single job that posted in the employment agency, their, you know, current location, how much they're getting paid, what kind of job that's being posted, right? Especially the location, right? Mm-hmm. So we were able to map the location and salary. Meanwhile, we're also mapping the Chinatown bus, right? Because it's actually a coherent story. You see pretty much nice overlap between the spatial location of immigrant jobs and then the Chinatown bus, you know, lines in different parts of the country. So that's where I'm right now, that I'm trying to sort of wrap up the story to see what we can learn. So maybe the final thing I want to say, I think my time probably running out, is we also carry out a survey of entrepreneurs who venture into other places. So we did a survey of six states in the U.S., talked to about six entrepreneurs in each of the six states. And so we have collected questionnaires, you know, very in-depth interviews. Some surprising story, for example, one person we talked about in Texas, you know, he was saying the money is very easy to make here. You know, try come here. So that's maybe I'll stop here and then we'll come talk later.
Thank you. Okay. So I guess I'll start off the way John did too and talk a little bit about my background, but I'll give you like the titles of the work that I've been doing, and then you'll see kind of when you hear my background why I'm interested in these works. So my dissertation, a PhD dissertation, was on garment workers comparing Chinese and Latino garment workers. And that book is called Sewing Women, so some of you know that. And that'll be coming out again in paperback in the fall. So it'll be a lot cheaper if you guys haven't gotten it yet. So that's a plug. Anyways, and then so I also wrote about the garment workers and their transformation after 9/11 into home health aid workers and what happened to Chinatown after 9/11 that was kind of moving on. And I have a small study on ethnic media that I haven't finished yet, but I'm still working on. And then my newest work is called Working the Real World, which is on Asian American college graduates, the second generation, the ones who were born here. So I'll go back and I'll describe myself, and you'll kind of see the connections all throughout. So I was actually born here in New York City, and not in Chinatown, surprisingly, but on the Upper West Side of Manhattan. If any of you know Lincoln Center and know the projects right behind it, that's where I was born, in the hospital nearby, Roosevelt Hospital, and then I grew up in those projects. And my mother was a garment worker, and my father was a restaurant worker. So I grew up in those projects, working class, community, always public school. I went to Stuyvesant High School. And at that time, when I grew up in the projects, my projects were, I'd say, mostly African-American, Latino. There were some Asian-Americans there, mostly Japanese-Americans and Chinese-Americans. And we all went to the neighborhood public schools. And since it was half, the public schools were half African-American, my whole class was half African-American, and we all went to Stuyvesant together. So it was a very different time at Stuyvesant High School. So I grew up very differently, and mostly because at that time, the projects were in a community that was gentrifying. So the schools actually were actually pretty good because we had middle class, upper, wealthy folks going to the public schools, as well as the kids from the projects all going together. And so we as a whole were able to have a better education and I think access places like Stuyvesant High School. And actually some of the kids that I went to school with who came from the projects, they went off to Brooklyn Tech, Stuyvesant, Stanford, Haverford, Swarthmore, and we still keep in contact. And they're African American and Latinos. So people always wonder what's going on, and I can kind of tell you, this is what's going on, the changes in the system. So anyway, so that's kind of like how I grew up. And so my heart has always been with the working people in New York City, just because I grew up with the working people in New York City. And when I went to college, I went off to Harvard. And I started off as a math major. And I never finished as a math major, so you know. I started off as a math major because I went to Stuyvesant and everybody thought I was good in math, and you know, I was good in math. But when I got to Harvard, I realized you need a lot more passion to be able to write to be able to write those proofs and to prove those things in math. And at Harvard, to graduate in the math with a math degree, you need to write a thesis. And my heart was not into writing a thesis in math. Not at all. So my idea was, by the time I was a junior, the fall of junior year, I said, can I just not get an honors degree and just not do a thesis? And they basically said, well, not really. If you want a math degree, you need to write a thesis. But what you can do is to graduate in something else. And so I ended up graduating with an applied math degree. And so I tell my students and everybody else too that you can change your mind many, many times in your career. So my first change was when to graduate, I didn't graduate with a math degree. I graduated with an applied math degree and ended up taking some classes in sociology and statistics and in computer science, and so I ended up doing just fine. And I graduated with an applied math degree and I ended up going into the work world. Not in sociology, but in the work world. So I actually worked for IBM for 6 years before getting my PhD because I had an applied math degree and a pretty good knowledge of computer science. So that's where that work in the real world comes in, my latest study, because I'm actually interested in professionals and Asian Americans. Because when I went to IBM, I was one of very few Asian Americans. There are more coming in a lot later, but I was one of very few, but I could tell that I was among the group of African Americans and Latinos, just like I was growing up, who had the advantage of affirmative action in the workplace. And we were sent to many different places to train, but also we were given mentors, we were given sponsors in these workplaces, many things that I found that a lot of these young folks today in the work world don't have, that I had the advantage of having when I went to work in the professional world. So anyway, so I worked for IBM for about 6 years and I realized that's not quite my passion too, because deep down inside I realized that there was not a whole lot written other than Peter's work about the people in Chinatown, right, at that time. So this is in the 90s, because I went to grad school in 1990 at Columbia University with John. He was there when we were there together.
Did you know each other?
Chinatown.
Yeah, the Chinese Progressive Association. Yeah. Right. So we both volunteered because we were both interested in the community, but we also went to grad school together, right? So anyway, so that's our history. Anyway, so then I said, okay, I wanted to study the garment workers in the community because nobody had really written about them, or even the restaurant workers. So I decided, well, how do I do this? And I didn't even know at that point that I wanted to do sociology. I went to different departments. I went to history, and they said, no, you actually have to study a period. You can't study contemporary Chinese. So I decided not history. I went to anthropology. Anthropology said, well, you can't study just New York. You have to study somewhere outside. I said, how about California and New York? And they said, no, you have to study overseas. And I said, okay, that's not for me either. So I went to sociology. I'm telling you, it's okay if you're an undergrad or whatever, it's okay to do a little exploration. That's the last question, what advice you would give. So you can do your exploration and you can change your majors and you can do whatever. And then you end up doing what you want to do. So I ended up in sociology because I knocked on Herbert Gans's door. And he said, you want to do what? And I said, I want to study garment workers. And he goes, yeah, why don't you come to this program? Come to this program. So I applied. And then I went to IBM and I said, I want to apply to actually go to graduate school. You know, is it possible for me to do this? And they said, you know what? Why don't you take a 2-year sabbatical and think about it? So that's the kind of support that I actually got from even the corporate work world, because I think it's a little bit different time at that point in time. So anyway, so I went off and I actually stayed. I never went back to IBM. I got my PhD at Columbia in 1998. And then I took a few years. I wrote my dissertation on garment workers, Chinese garment workers, and I compared them with Latino garment workers in New York City, who were mostly Mexican, Ecuadorian, and Dominican at that time. And I looked at the Chinese garment industry inside of Chinatown. And so I looked at the differences, how they hired, and why the Chinese industry, actually, the workers were paid less, although they're unionized, while at the same time, the Latino workers were paid hourly, and they actually got more, and plus, there are quite a few of them who are undocumented. And I tried to figure out why. And one of the reasons for the Chinese was that it was actually something that they were all complicit at. It was a way of letting the Chinese workers work and to take care of their kids, balance their work hours, and get union benefits. But at the same time, the workers knew that they were kind of exploited, but they wouldn't say it in those many words, but they knew they were. But if they didn't do it this way, they wouldn't be able to take care of their kids, they wouldn't be able to run in and out the shops, they wouldn't be able to get the health benefits. So it was kind of like an agreement they had with each other. Whereas the Latino workers, they didn't have their families here at that time. They didn't have too many kids here at that time. So they worked their hourly wages, and they knew that they were exploited too, but they were going to take advantage of it. If they weren't getting paid at least the minimum wage, they would just leave their shop and go to another. Because at that time in the mid-1990s, the garment industry was still pretty strong here in New York City. So anyway, I did that for my dissertation. And then when I left, I actually worked with Kathy Newman, and I did a study on the working poor, looking at blacks and Latinos transitioning out of welfare. So, but then that was done basically with people who lived in the projects, so kind of with people like I grew up with. So it was easy to get in to do work with them. And if you can't tell by now, I don't use any of my math background. I actually do all qualitative field work. I go in and I interview, and I do field work inside the garment shops. I go visit people in their homes, and I interview people at their jobs as well. So my stuff is all qualitative these days. My latest study is on Asian American college graduates. Those who were born here and those who came here underneath the age of under 13, and kind of looking at how their family experiences and their college experiences have basically shaped their trajectory in the work world. So I'm kind of looking at the glass ceilings and kind of looking at where the majority of these Asian Americans are at now. It's a brand new study, so you can ask me questions about what I'm finding a little bit later, which I have some findings. But I might just, I think I'm almost up to 10 minutes, right? Okay. So I might just close off, and then I'll let Peter
sure.
speak.
Mm-hmm. Sounds good. Thank you, Margaret. Peter?
I didn't know you were studying science. Wow. I left engineering.
Oh, you too. Oh, wow. See, there you go.
And math and physics, as soon as I got my BA from Columbia. And wanted to switch to any social science field that wanted me. And I got into political science. And the reason I really was not interested was because I got into science just like all Taiwan you know, people from Taiwan, everybody wants to go into science. And if you go into humanities, literature, arts, then you're a real loser. I mean, you know, in your class. So that was not what I wanted to do. But once I got into engineering, I just had absolutely no interest whatsoever. But I was very interested to understand who was around me, what was happening. And politically, economically, you know, at that time, I'm talking about the 60s now, okay? It was a turbulent world. There was the civil rights boom. There was the anti-war movement. All these things going on. Here I was, you know, I mean, obviously I was not interested. Besides, when I was studying engineering, living in the old days, International House, you know where International House? Which is right near Columbia.
Yeah, the rivers.
And we have all, I live with all these graduate students.
Yeah.
And they are not interested in anything I have to say, right? They look at Asians as simply either nerds, well, in those days, not nerds, engineers, or, you know, laundrymen or whatever. So, and there's no voice. I mean, Asian Americans in those days are such small group of people. And I just felt, you know, I have certain understanding, and it did, you know, I just couldn't voice it. So that's why I got into social sciences. And once I got into political science, I was very excited. I was studying comparative politics, China, Japan, and Soviet Union. And I got into all these theories and, you know, dialectics and all that stuff. I was really having a good time. Then pretty soon I realized, what the hell am I doing? All these abstract things has no relevance to what I was doing. What I was really interested in, what's going on around. You know, we talk about, you know, hydraulic authoritarian society and all that kind of crap. And also very, very reactionary. You know, those days, we Cold War years. And I just didn't fit. And so pretty soon I realized this is not where I belong either. One of the things that challenged me was that when I'm interested in things, I feel very personal about it, emotional about it. But the books, the authors, you know, all these things are written in a very remote sense. My fellow students have no, I mean, you know, they're Chinese specialists or whatever, you know, Russian specialists, but they don't feel any kind of attachment to these things they study. And also very arrogant and racist. And so I could pretty soon drop out of that whole climate, and that was just the time of 1968 at Columbia and the emergence of Asian American movement. So pretty soon I slip into that. I tried to do things that was minimally satisfying to me at that time. So my master essay was on the Red Guards. As you know, student movement was unfolding, and it was also Red Guards. I mean, you know, this is what we understood those days: fighting for equality, fighting for the rights of sons and daughters of poor peasants and workers. And this is a time we were fighting for affirmative action for minorities. So this was my master essay was you know, was a way to get out of that. But then after that, I just didn't know what to go on. So slowly drift into become a activist, anti-war, starting from campus, then to anti-war movement and the civil rights, Asian American movement, and then I moved to Chinatown. Chinatown? If you want to do work, you better move to Chinatown. So that's what, 1970, I moved to Chinatown and really involved myself full time in community work and just pretty much drop out of the PhD program. But then after a few years working, you know, I was in Third World Coalition, anything that you could ever imagine, I was there, right? Attica, you know, you don't know Attica, but anyways. So it's you know, it was a really exciting time. But then as the movement declined, you know, I mean, things really seems, you know, I mean, it wasn't as we thought it was going to be. We thought the revolution was going to come and didn't come. And everybody going back to do their, you know, regular stuff. All the radicals now are going back to graduate school and whatever. So I realized the amount of work I was doing in the community didn't pan out. There was a lot of contradictions, there were a lot of obstacles, and I then realized, you know, just being active without some kind of perspective, some kind of theoretical knowledge behind you is no good. Mm-hmm. So this is when I get back to the graduate school, and I said to my department, I said, well, I don't do about mobilization in Chinatown in the 1930s, which is a period mirror very much about what happened in the 60s, right? I wanted to learn from the 30s, the radicals in the Chinese community, the moderates, the liberals. And they said to me, what are you talking about? We don't have anybody specialized in this. We can't let you do this. So finally I went to Chuck Hamilton, was African-American, the only African-American faculty in the political science department, who's willing to, whose politics is not exactly great, but was willing to usher everybody, whoever wants. So I actually did under him, and finally got my degree. But what happened at that point, however, I realized my life had changed. And in a way, I realized that, finally realized what role I could play. How do I balance being activist and being a scholar? And so, so from that point on, I didn't really make that much compromise, although with great deal of negative consequence to my career. But I stick to three things. One is, I do research, right, based on my own activist activities. So, I was working with restaurant workers. I write about restaurant workers in Chinatown, the sweatshop workers later on, the garment workers, the immigrant workers, etc., etc. So I stick to the things that I'm actually working at. Now this is a no-no, right? People from academic things, you know, how could you be actively involved and do scholar work? And this is one of the things that really I was punished again and again. But nevertheless, I always felt that there is a hidden truth, another dimension of truth that regular scholars do not see. So in other words, you know, you could read, you could, you know, do all these things. You could talk to people, interview people, but things are not the same when, you know, people say a group, that's what they believe, that's what they do, but when in actual struggle, it's not the same thing. The kind of issues they come up, challenge them, all that stuff. So this is the area of facts that I think it was very important to capture. Now these are facts, they are not biased positions. So this is what I thought was very, very important to capture. The second thing that I thought was important from my point of view is, even though I'm an activist, I want to land theoretical depth, mm-hmm. right? So as an activist, I'm always trying to bring in this theoretical understanding about things, and theoretical understanding about mm-hmm. struggles. The third perspective is, I'm not interested in writing academic books. I'm interested in reaching out as many people as possible. Mm-hmm. Right? So this led to a very, very different kind of trajectory. I'm an activist scholar. I don't want to be observer. I'm writing about things I'm actually involved in, sometimes actually participants in. And so my work, in the written works, I prefer to write for mass audience. Mm-hmm. So the books I published, they are all through trade journal, trade publishers. They're not academic stuff. The advantage that is reaching a lot more people. Mm-hmm. Right? So most of my books have a lot more circulations. One of the things that really amazed me, I was, you mentioned about the New Chinatown.
Mm-hmm.
The New Chinatown was published 1987. Mm-hmm. Younger than you. I mean, older than you, right? I'm still getting royalty.
Yeah, by 10.
I'm still, people would say, you know, Peter, I become active because I read this book.
Mm-hmm.
So clearly shows that the work is a little bit different from others. And the other thing is, I write for mass publications.
Mm-hmm.
I struggle so hard. You know, I'm a foreigner. English is not my first language. As you probably know, my English grammar oftentimes got problems. But I wanted to write for mass publications. And I struggle, try to make up my sentence shorter and not using big words, try to digest things in a way that and present to people that people could understand. This is what I try to do. So I was fortunate enough to get to write for The Nation, The Village Voice. I was actually senior editor for Village Voice. At one time I thought I was going to quit teaching. Later on, my article is published in International Herald Tribune in many, many places. And for a while, I was doing all kinds of very exciting things, which has nothing to do with my field anymore. As you probably know, the Korean African American problems in the late 80s,
mm-hmm.
And I was practically the only Asian Americans writing articles about that. I would go to African American community, they would tell me, you know, we don't want to talk to you Koreans, get out of here. But anyway, so I wrote this whole series of articles, and one of them is about the riots after 1993 in Los Angeles. That was nominated for Academy Award, for Pulitzer Prize. Russell should know, I never published any articles in your referee journal. I did very, very few referee journals because I just, the kind of stuff I write, you know, people just get upset. You know, going through.
People just get upset.
There's not enough sauce. Well, where's the quotes and all that kind of crap. But I published tons of articles that's published actually in academic edited books encyclopedia. But anyway, there's another dimension of my work is that as an activist scholar, I try to get my knowledge out. So one of the things I do all the time, even to this day, is constantly being interviewed and try to get interviews through magazines, through media. So, you know, I mean, probably some of you know that I'm often quoted, mm-hmm. giving long discourse to these reporters, and then they will quote me one, two sentences, which has nothing to do with. But anyway, that's what I do. But there is another hat that you probably don't know. I'm along the line of mass distribution. I started involved in documentary filmmaking, 1974. Over the years, I helped produce 30 some documentaries for co-production. Many of them got international award. One of them was nominated for Academy Award in 2010. So again, this is my way of trying to get my work through. It's interesting, documentary, the reason I first got into documentary was I was teaching at Old Westbury. Old Westbury College is one of the worst college you could ever imagine because Rockefeller at that time wanted to give money to quote-unquote minorities. And so built this college and we recruited the worst possible kids you could ever imagine in the city, right? And then bring them into Old Westbury, Long Island. It's the most prestigious neighborhood in the area. And we have a whole bunch of idealistic, stupefying faculty thinking we could change, you know. So at that time, you know, you can't lecture because kids are not concentrating on you. You can't ask them to write things, right? So eventually, I started talking to them about where they're from, what kind of problems they have. Once you get that, they have tons of stuff to come out. And this is when, you know, I started to use documentary to get these things out. And through that process, I actually recruited half a dozen people to get into who Amy Goodman's, one of the executive producers who can't write a single sentence, but she flower in documentary. So that's another aspect what I did. Now, so in a way, I was lucky enough, published enough, so I was able to get tenure and promoted. At the same time, I was able to do all kinds of things other people didn't have time or didn't have the inclination to do. So sometimes my work will be a combination of three. So restaurant workers, Chinatown restaurant workers, I first started talking about it. Today Show in NBC, you don't watch Today Show anymore. Today Show in the old days was really the only thing that's really very, very popular. From that, I wrote many articles and published, and from that, I wrote The New Chinatown, taught me that. And then, of course, in New Chinatown, one of the things I did was try to understand the structure of Chinese community. And I was one write about tongues, organized crime, put in the context of Chinese communities. And subsequent, a lot of reporters don't want to know anything else I wrote in Chinatown. They always want me to talk about organized crime, tongues and stuff. Anyway, by what I did was to, in film as well in journals, mass journals, is constantly trying to see myself as both as a filmmaker but also a scholar, always trying to inject some theoretical content. And this is where I'm getting fights with my editors, with filmmakers. John Albert is one of the most leading filmmakers that I work with. All these, we always have to fight. I said, this shit does not have any content, so you gotta have some perspective in it. He would say, how the hell are you gonna do it? We have to find people to talk about this. So this is always been fighting this. So this is my input.
Your challenge, that's a challenge for you.
That's what I do all the time. So my works actually range, obviously Chinatown, but China. I wrote extensively on human rights issues mm-hmm. in China. That's the documentary nominated for Academy Award. Is basically in that lane. I was working for NBC and the PBS during June 4th massacre. Mm. A lot of you don't know that's 20 years ago. Anyway. So what is my theoretical approach? Political economy is my foundation. Mm-hmm. I see political economy is what drives things. But I'm also very in mind of that things is not is. It's always a process of change. So evolving from something to something else and with the future. So I'm very, very strong in emphasizing history. Now, a dash of sociology that people are human animals that we group together, do things, and form institutions. And this is what people call culture. And I call it stickiness of reality. In other words, you do things for a certain specific purpose, then you get stuck. That becomes a pattern of behavior. Now, in that sense, then dabble in sociology is to say that it explains certain things, but it's also that can be changed. Let me just
see. Yeah.
So finally, just to say why I'm doing all this. What is the craziness? And I never understand why I do this, except I think when I was a kid, I read too many martial art Chinese novels.
How's that connected?
Make it plain.
If you read Water Margin, if you read all those, it's always about fighting against injustice.
Oh, right? I see.
Fighting against government, yes, fighting against the rich. A merchant fighting a landlord, it's always the little guy, right? This is mm-hmm. what Kung Fu movie is all about, right? So that to me, I always pick the side that I think being abused and taken advantage of people lied to. So this is why my analysis oftentimes is a class thing, right? In another ways, I'm a very classical Chinese scholar. A Chinese scholar is supposed to be one of the, I don't know how exactly, it's basically a scholar is the one should be the first one to worry about things before everybody else understand. And this is the person who is the last person to get relaxed, right, passing mm-hmm. the crisis. And so, in this sense, I'm supposed to be a critic. I'm a social critic. I have nothing good to say about anything. I'm very judgmental and I'm a pain in the ass. Anyway, that's it.
Thank you. I'm wondering, we could open this up now, or I'm wondering if you guys have questions for each other about what you each talked about in terms of what motivates your research, methods, challenges. I'm wondering if you have questions for each other first before we open it up.
I think we better
open up.
Open up? Oh, you look like you were about
no,
to
No, because
ask.
We talked so long, I was suggesting
Fine.
We open it up.
Okay,
yeah.
Great. Sure, are there any comments or questions or?
Ken?
I just wanted to say yes, you're okay in our ass. And we appreciated that.
Well, I actually have a question, and maybe it'll get you guys to ask. It's like, how do you get into the field? Like, how do you go about getting, like he explained, right, about how he's an activist and that's how he gets his data. So how do we each all do it? It would be a good question to ask. Because I think that's a really good point, about the ways people go about doing that. Like, how do you get your massage parlor data?
Well, that's really fresh on my mind, so I could talk a little bit about that. it's been really hard to get women to talk to us who work in massage parlors.
Exactly.
So we've tried many strategies. One is going just straight to the massage parlor. Has not worked. If a woman shows up, especially to the massage parlor, they don't want to talk to that person. I actually went with a friend of mine to a massage parlor because he wanted a massage, and his wife was there too. And so the three of us went to the massage parlor, and we said, his back is really hurting him. He needs a massage. She said, take him to the hospital. Meaning, you know, we don't do that here. So we've also tried newspaper advertising. So we're now advertising in World Journal and also some of the Korean newspapers in the employment section. So we say there is actually an employment section where people are searching for masseuses for massage parlors, mm-hmm. and you can put an ad there saying, you know, if you're in a massage parlor and you want to be interviewed, and we'll pay you $100 and come call this number. So that's worked a little bit, not so great. The best thing actually, unfortunately, in a way, has been the court system. So we interview women, we encounter women after they've been arrested. The courts have actually developed a very compassionate approach where they try to get the women into these health workshops. So a 5-session counseling situation or 8-session workshop. And we get to know the women there and then are able to form a relationship. And then from there, it's using those social networks. So we met a Korean woman who's kind of like a opinion leader in her peer group. So if we talk to her, then she'll hook us up with folks. And if we encounter people independently, if they know her, they actually have to ask her first if they can speak to us. So it's sort of snowballed from there.
So, yeah, I always wanted John to get me to be advisor of this project. It's because my book, The Forbidden Workers, Illegal Immigrants, was published, and CBS News called me up, says, you know, we're doing a story about prostitutes. I said, what's it got to do with me? He says, well, you know, you talk about the illegal immigrants that had to pay debts, right? So this is really part of the thing. And I said, well, you know, okay, I'd be willing to talk to you. They said, no. Would you be willing to do undercover work for us? Mm-hmm. I said, what does that mean? He says, well, could you go to the prostitute places and talk to the prostitutes? And we have a camera, hidden camera. So that's what I did for the next 2 months, going to this massage parlor and pay for the fees, and once they're telling them I just need a massage, and so I don't have to take off my clothes. So that was my research. I did a lot of writing after that about that was.
If you ever get a chance to see that video, it's amazing actually. Peter puts himself, it looks very dangerous actually, because it's a suburban house with a male guard at the door. He has, I mean, this was what, the 80s with a huge camera and a
90s.
Bag. Kind of like hidden like a gym bag or something like that. And he goes in there by himself and it's crazy, yeah.
And you talk to them, you ask them questions.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I was going to say, Peter, why don't you tell them when they saw your hands, what they said.
Nice. So one of the girls says, you know, what do you do for a living? I said, I work in a restaurant. She says, you're not working in restaurants. Uh-huh. I said, how do you know? She says, look at your hands. You don't have any roughness.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
She was in that.
I have a question for John that pertains to something that you shared about that one in your interviewing the workers, the massage workers, that one of them felt that she was doing a community service.
Yeah.
Now that, I'm wondering about the race and gender aspects to this. I mean, who are the clients of these massage parlors? Are they
other Asian men? Are they Asian men or are they non-Asian
right,
men?
Right, right. You know, I don't actually know. My impression is that they're mostly not Asian men. They're white, Latino, and maybe some African American. You know, we don't ask specifically, but they tell stories about who their clients are, and in those stories they reveal some of the ethnic
background. Depends where the massage parlor is.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Right, but you're in the city, so you're not in the suburbs, you're in the five boroughs. Is there a clustering of the spatial location of these types
of
businesses?
Yeah, I mean, they do tend to cluster in the high Asian immigrant areas. Oh. You know, so Sunset Park, Flushing, downtown Chinatown, Manhattan, and a lot in Koreatown.
Midtown.
We also did some quantitative analysis, and we sort of did spatial regression with census data, and we're finding association also with high rates of male employment. So we're thinking that, you know, they go where the market is as well. So they go where the labor pool is, plus the client pool. So there's some economic dynamics happening there too.
And these are similar findings in the LA case?
Yes,
So Tara, I had a couple of questions. I guess I'd love to hear people talk a little bit more about this scholar activist piece and the motivations behind that. I think it's not easy.
Right.
And I mean, Peter's been very incredibly articulate about a long journey of this and it not being easy at different steps along the way and the kind of pushback we get from our institutions. I know that as I took a turn to writing more popularly for undergraduate students and trying to address issues of power and stratification in cultural anthropology, nobody in my institution here wanted me to do that. They all said, you'll never get tenure, you'll never get promoted. And there was a battle about that at that point. So I think, I just think our institutional lives are not, are lined up against that kind of engagement. And I wonder if you could say a little bit about that, what motivates you, how you fought that battle, how you continue to fight that, right?
Yeah, I can tell you. So I got an award from the Coalition of Labor Union Workers because when I did my garment worker stuff, it was all about organizing the women. So it was all about, and then also going into, because I was doing field work inside the Latino garment shops owned by Korean owners, and these workers were undocumented, and they were also trying to unionize those shops at that particular time. So when I went in, the way I got in was actually through the union, and because they needed information. And I said, you know what, if you help me in, I'll give you information. And so that's how I got in. So I wasn't totally an activist, but in many ways, I was working with and understanding them at the same time as understanding them for what they wanted and what they needed to do and why these undocumented Latinos would actually come to the U.S. to share that information so that the union can actually provide services for them. That was the whole idea. So that was a way of getting into it. So you know, at that time, because I was a graduate student, right, I didn't feel that push from the scholarly aspect. My advisors were perfectly fine with me that I made this bargain. They knew I was doing this, that to get my information, so long as you're safe, you're protected. They were more worried that nothing would happen to me, right? But if the union was supporting me, they were like even more for it. So I have to say that at that point in time, it was actually very much coincide as a graduate student to be an activist and to actually lend my support to working with the undocumented at that same time. So it wasn't, a discrepancy at all. When I got to working at Hunter, I just realized that, you know, to be an activist, you actually need to spend more time, right? And then what happened was there was no time to be an activist and to be a scholar and to be a teacher. And so if I had more time, I probably would still be an activist and still teaching and still doing research. But as it is, you can only do little bits of each. So if I find information that I think is relevant, I do share it with whatever community organizations are out there. but I don't publish it. You know, like I never published that, but it says in my book that I had information from the union and the union allowed me to get, it's all in there, but it's not like I don't share what I tell the union in my book. That's how I do it. And I think even now when I get information like that, that I think it's relevant and that's helpful for the working poor, helpful for any group, I still share it with a community group that might have to. And that part of it is that my father, he came here when he was 12. And he volunteered most of, because he was totally bilingual, Chinese and English. He went to New Rochelle High School. So he actually volunteered for the Chinese American Planning Council. So always as a translator. So he's always been like, you know, whatever you find, you share with people and the organizations might be helpful. And so likewise, my whole life, when I wanted information and needed to share things, they would come to me or I would go to them because of my father's contacts. Or because of my mother's work in the garment industry, and she knew people in the union, and all these different things. So it's more like family, or more, you know. But that's the only way I could make it work. Mm-hmm. So I wasn't, you know, wasn't explicit so much that I was an activist, but people who knew would be able to find out.
I'd like to ask, Sai, you had. Alluded to that you were using data that you got in China, is that right? So these are official data sources from China, but you were studying a topic that was politically very sensitive. So how did you navigate that?
Yeah.
Well, before I do that, maybe I can add something that Margaret just saying. Uh-huh. The whole debate about scholar and, you know, sort of the community more engagement. I guess my approach on that is, I think particularly for junior scholar who are waiting for tenure, perhaps the best thing is, you know, the priority should be on the, you know, peer review publication. You know, that's my approach. You know, otherwise it's kind of risky, right? Whether you can get tenure, that's kind of important for anybody's career. But it is important to getting involved in community. In particular, if your project is funded for, you know, by the public, you know, the federal mm-hmm. agencies, yeah. I think our, you know, we scholars, so, you know, have an obligation, we have to contribute to the dialogue, to dissemination of knowledge about whatever you find, right? So therefore, I think at some point that I decided I have, you know, when the reporter called me, I have to, you know, return the call. And whatever I know, I have to tell them, you know, about what I think. Even like last week about this five article series in the Wall Journal, the Chinese newspaper, Shijie Ribao, about, you know, they talk about the mental health issues, mm-hmm. you know, they call me, I say, this is what I know about this. Just, mm-hmm. you know, in the last few, 2 months, you know, the whole family was killed in Gilman, in Albany, yeah. right, in Sunset Park.
Yes.
So a lot of concern, you know, from mainstream, mm-hmm. you know, media and also the community. So I told them what I know about the community. Mm-hmm. I think the other thing, that connection with community is also important because that's where your research ideas will come from as well, right? As you're getting more and more knowledge about the community, new ideas for new project will come up. So to me, it's sort of reinforcing at a certain stage. So I'm getting back to Terry's question about using data from China. Yeah, I think that's, you know, I think at this point in 21st century, I think China is much open than the time that I was collecting the mm-hmm. data. But when I was collecting the data in 2004, it was pretty intense. So I traveled to Fujian pretty much twice a year. So you hear old story about people's, you know, other researchers whose computer was searched, right? You know, mm-hmm. went to the hotels, so all the stories. Mm-hmm. So I made it clear that you know, my goal is clear. I want to collect data, but I don't want to get into trouble. So that's the part where I collaborate with my mm-hmm. colleagues there when we do the major data collection. But after we did a survey, actually, I went back to these communities because we got the data, and then, you know, even there's a risk, you know, now we got the data. So went back, we have done a lot more interviews to see some story that's not reflected in the survey data, and then the other thing that I was using the data collected by the Chinese government, like the census. I think that census data is not as sensitive as the one that I collected myself. So essentially that you just, you know, gather information about the household where they have, you know, immigrants went abroad, right? So that's all we know. It didn't say how much money you had to pay. It didn't say you use snake heads, right? You know, so smuggling operation, there's nothing like that. So I think I walk a line that when I use the data from the Chinese government, that's as much as I can gather. Just talk about the basic descriptive story, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas talking about the real operational snake heads, right? That's from my interviews. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Makes sense.
Are there any other questions?
No, I just wanted to comment, Mark, your comment about you, there was sort of an exchange that you kind of work with the union and you kind of negotiated, you know, you help me, I'll help you. So I think that's sort of a kind of a key point, because right now I'm volunteering for the CP Chinatown Planning Council, mm-hmm. and I help edit their stuff on HIV and AIDS. I do it in English, and then it's translated into Chinese, and we try mm-hmm. to distribute to various massage parlors. But we're having a lot of it's very, very difficult. If a woman, there was an article in the Chinese newspaper a couple of days ago. Two of our staff members, women, went, and they were kind of turned down. But if a guy goes, like a middle-aged or old guy like me goes, they'll open the door, the right demographic. Mm. But then how do you distribute the, you know, the condoms and the literature? Because that's assuming that, you know, they are doing something illegal, so they won't accept it. Mm-hmm. However, maybe your point about that in every, when you do community research, the community needs to get something also.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, so it's this, you know, two-way process, not just a researcher going in and using it as mining the data mm-hmm. and not giving anything back,
exactly.
but something really concrete.
Exactly.
Like with the union. So maybe, you know, if we had classes at GP, you know, at the Chinatown Planning Council to help women, you know, whether it's job training or other kinds of jobs, then it is sort of more of an exchange thing for it, you know, whatever it might be. It takes a lot more thought, though, because you have to kind of ascertain what people in these massage parlors, you know, want, or whether they actually even want to, you know, get out of the business. And so, you know, the other point I was going to say is I think a lot more Asians go there than might meet the eye, because one time I was in the park in Chinatown, and my Tai Chi Shifu teacher was about 80, and I said, oh yeah, I'm divorced now, what should I do? He said, don't marry those women from mainland China. They're bad news. I said, but I might have knees. He says, oh, just pay $30, go to a massage parlor. That's what my teacher told me. So I think that a lot of, you know, there's a lot of guys hanging around. I'm sure that they actually go, although it might not be, you know, I don't think it's just all white guys or something. Or half American,
mm-hmm.
but you know,
mm-hmm. that's definitely
pretty
yeah.
standard thing,
yeah.
actually.
Yeah,
and so you know, I mean, I was even given advice by my teacher, who's pretty well educated. So you know, I think it's just part of the fact.
I think it depends on the location, really.
Yeah. Where you hang out, right?
Yeah.
But I just think your point about, you know, this exchange is a good one that we can all apply to our own research, because you know, whether it's Peter or you, you know, I mean, all of you, you know, I mean. Seems like you are giving, you know, following that principle.
Yeah, I think sometimes we look too agental about these things, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And I think this is where active scholar is very difficult, and I'm not recommending everybody do it, because everybody has different angles to contribution. For instance, I have total different experience with unions, right? As an active scholar, I call on the unions for not, right, protecting the workers. So my writing oftentimes is criticizing unions, and they are on my neck all the time. But the point, this is what I'm saying, a union says this is what we do. We protect our workers, we have the contract, and they've done none of that, right? So you criticize them, what do you get pushed back? Academics, liberals don't want you to criticize unions, mm-hmm. right? They think you're conservative reactionaries. and the unions have all their, you know, I mean, so this is, it is something, it's more than just cooperating or go along. I mean, it's a lot more complicated.
I'm Diana Pan, I'm assistant professor of sociology at Brooklyn College. So this definition of community research, right? I've been thinking about this a lot, inspired by Peter's work when I was an undergrad. But what about individuals who study up, right? And I think this points more to perhaps Margaret's current study. So how does one give back to this community writ large that perhaps you may not want to give back to the community writ large, if that makes sense? If, like, let's say you're studying, you know, CEOs, and writ large, the community of CEOs are primarily, you know, white males, right? But you're studying a particular segment, for example, perhaps Asian Americans, Latinos, whatever. So how does one give back in those instances? And how does one contribute to the community? That's my broader question, is how do we define a community? And that's an obstacle in my own work right now.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So my latest work is on studying the people who are moving up into the VP level, the directorate level, who are these Asian Americans. So a lot of them are managerial. So the way I see it is that actually there's a lot of discrimination out there. Mm-hmm. There's still a lot of race is still very important in the work world. And so the larger question is, even among the people who are what we would coin successful, it's still very important to talk about the role of Asian Americans, where Asian Americans still fit into our society, and how it's still not black and white. Mm-hmm. So for the community per se, it may not help any individuals, right? It may help some who read the study, may figure out how to move up, but for the larger, I guess, picture and the larger arguments about how and where Asian Americans fit in, it may open the conversation up more, you know, and so that Asian Americans can be seen as diverse. You have some people who are up there, but you have some other people who are not, and some of the reasons why people may not be able to make it up. So it's enlarging the argument, enlarging the way we look at the community, the nuances that are there. So I feel like it's a way of changing the perceptions of Asian Americans and changing that model minority view. So that's how I would see it, mm-hmm. as contributing.
Especially when Asians are used as a
all
wedge.
All the time, right. Mm-hmm. As the wedge all the time, mm-hmm. exactly. Right. Like that, the pet tweet thing, whatever, I forget what that thing is called.
Direct action has tangible,
yeah.
You know, whatever, executive reports you can give. But in this case, short of being just mainstream. Process.
Actually, I think, I think it's a lot.
Yeah. Well, go ahead, when you finish.
In the 80s, I started writing about the professionals. And the reason I got involved in that has nothing to do, you know, I was doing all these community research, and what's that big research foundation?
Russell Sage?
No. Anyway.
William T. Grant? No.
It's one of the
Science Research Council.
One of the most prestigious research, scientific research, Westinghouse sponsored. Excuse me?
Intel, Westinghouse?
Anyway, I forgot. Anyway, it was, they called me up, they said, you know, we have the Asian American month, and we would like you to give a talk to our engineers, right, Asian engineers. So I said to them, you know, I don't do that kind of research, you know. They said, just come, anything you want to talk to, right? So I flew into Cincinnati, and I walk into this room. There were about 1,000 Asian American engineers, right? And one white person, and that's the guy who invited me. So I started talking about, I didn't know what to say. I just said about, you know, Asian American state of, you know, situation and all that kind of stuff. And I gingerly mentioned the issue of glass ceiling. Mm-hmm. And I concluded the conversation. Just before I finished, just finish it, somebody jump up, said, challenge me, what do you mean by glass ceiling? I said, you know, glass ceiling means, you know, you go to a certain stage, you can't. That's exactly what's happening. Everybody starts screaming, right? Indians and Chinese and everybody talk about, so they would say, you know, we have 21 ranks, and all Asians, when they get to the 8th rank, they don't go up, right? So I would be training this young white guy, you know, now he's my supervisor, and they were just bitching and moaning and all that kind of stuff. So that's how I got into doing research. The question here is, it's not unique, right? Everywhere else. So the question is, how do you deal with it? And this is a legal issue. It's also a corporate policy issue, right? So I went to California, PGS, Pacific Gas and Electric.
PG&E.
Yeah, this is one of the biggest. They have the same problems, and so they decided to challenge the corporate leadership in terms of changing their promotion policy. Instead of saying leadership quality, talk about achievement of goals, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And also forming the kind of legal strategy, because for civil rights basically do not deal with professionals, right? Civil rights deal with, you know, whatever. Civil rights is very, very weak dealing with, in other words, people trying to get into college, trying to become an engineer. Now you're an engineer, you're not getting promoted, right? So this is kind of thing, this is where all the research today, constantly people are, you know, legally as well as policy-wise, trying to reform and change. And what was really interesting is 3 years ago, one of the biggest law firm called me up. Says, we have Asian American Week. Could you come and talk? So I went to talk. These are very, very sophisticated. They are partners. I mean, big law firms, they accomplished, right? So I talk about glass ceiling. And I said, well, shit, you know, what else? I can't believe. They, first of all, many of them really was interested.
Yeah,
because
all really interesting.
That's what's going on. Even at the top law firms, even if you get into be partners, you feel this kind of discrimination. And then they have all these junior lawyers who is on their way coming up, not yet. And so I talk about the fact that, you know, I mean, one of the things which Asians are already doing is forming professional organizations, right? You have all these Asian American Lawyers Association, Wall Street Lawyers, blah, 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 blah. So these are very, very concrete things that I'm sometimes informed and also try to get people to think about these things. And this is how dealing with, this is something that's, it's there. It's people already know these are the problems, and what can we do, all right? I don't know anything about Wall Street, but certainly I know other places, what kind of struggles, what kind of corporate pressure they try to bring to try to change that. So anyway, these are continuous struggles.
Yeah.
Not to mention Asian American faculties.
That's the other one.
The other one, I just wanted to say, since all of you are scholars and, you know, pretty knowledgeable about many things, I think a lot of younger people, they actually would appreciate, or not even young people, mentorship, because that's one of the ways in which, it's one of those things in which, you know, you help to mentor other people. Actually could be really helpful, whether it's a business, academia, or so forth. So that's a way in which one could, you know, basically give something back by sharing the strategies and so forth.
Great. Thank you, Ms. Yes.
Hi, my name is Brian Savina. I'm wearing two hats today. I'm the Health Policy Coordinator at the Coalition for Asian American Children and Families. I'm also the Director of Policy and Advocacy at Filipino American Unity for Progress, a Filipino professional group, creating a collaborative Filipino community in New York City. And so, you know, I'm very inspired for what everyone has said, because with UNIPRO, we're trying to kind of do an assessment of the state of the Filipino American community in New York City, mm-hmm. and also kind of look at like the life cycle of Filipino American community organizations and how to promote sustainability. And so for my questions, because we're doing this like our foray into, you know, this research, what are your recommendations for, you know, for me or for others who are doing, you know, like these large, you know, community scale research and kind of like what Russell said is like, you know, what are kind of like best practices or kind of like recommendations for, you know, to do like these like large scale community involvement?
John, do you want to start?
Well, I would maybe just make a few obvious points. One is to think about your research design so that you can have some credibility when you share your findings. So thinking about the sampling, thinking about the survey design, all of that stuff. And then I would think to really recommend thinking about dissemination. So I know, you know, you work for, you know, you work with the CACF, so they're experts in dissemination. But really think about like what venues you want to use to put out that information and how do you envision the information getting out into the world. I think that'll sort of provide some direction to what you're doing.
Mm-hmm. And then in terms of like sampling, so I would talk to people at the top and people in the middle and the bottom. I mean, just so you know how some of these organizations work, because oftentimes, as Peter mentioned, you have to talk to a variety of people to understand, you know, and so I guess that's sampling. And then I think that's the clearest thing, to just get a variety. And then if you're doing something not just survey, but you're also doing qualitative stuff, one way of doing is that if you start getting similar answers over and over again, you know you've hit on the right points. And so you should just know that. You don't have to say a particular number. You don't have to say, I need 100. But after interviewing 25, even 30 people, and you start, they start repeating themselves, you know that you can start writing up and you might be able to form more in-depth questions too and go ahead. So that's one way of doing it.
I want to say one more thing, which is one of our visions for many mapping Asian-American New York is that we would have CUNY faculty as resources for community
for you,
projects. So, you know, let us know if you think there might be some possibilities for collaboration with some of the faculty here who are involved in the group and
Great. Good. Vivian.
Yes. Yeah. Thanks. So, just to build on the points that have been raised, so one, of course, will be less positive, but on Peter's point, and actually I knew Peter and Margaret from way back from my former lives in journalism when I was in the academy. And it's interesting, two very different industries, two different points in time, and yet what I would consistently hear behind closed doors from course or select audiences was that it's just so hard, it's a pipeline issue. It's so hard to get qualified people of color because they apparently just don't exist. And so, but you're the exception, or, you know, but it's really hard. And so I just want us to be mindful that that's still, you know, kind of current. And that also we shouldn't be satisfied with having one person get through the door, but that the door should be open to many more people, right? And that's where I think the close mentoring comes into play. And then getting to your question and then other things that have already been raised, so I have to plug the Liang Graph Foundation because I'm a program officer there. Brand new, just a couple months, great organization. And Vivian Tseng, who's our Vice President of Programs, has really been a kind of a national leader in building a grant making around the translation of research into practice and policy.
Yeah.
And one of the things that the foundation has just launched is a microsite. So it's an embedded website on our website. I'm happy to email the link at some point soon. But it basically provides guidelines and documentation to help build research and practice partnerships that are a two-way street, right? Not just research coming to community-based organizations or whatnot and saying, here's the research. Now, this is also, of course, with the caveat that both parties are really invested in having a two-way street, not what Peter has mentioned, for example, in his relationship with the labor unions, right? That probably wouldn't be a candidate here. But if there are both parties are kind of on the table with that, there'd be some good resources there. So just saying.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
About, yeah, actually, John's
good
presentation, mm-hmm, remind me, I one time I looked at your website for your massage project. I remember in terms of methodology for
mm-hmm
research. Yeah, it's kind of, you know, interesting to me that you actually looked something at your website, right?
Mm-hmm.
So can you tell
yeah
us, you know, in the 21st century, how do we use, mm-hmm, take advantage of this website, you know, to carry out research?
Yeah, yes. So we looked at websites that where clients review their massage parlor experience. So it's kind of like Yelp is for restaurants, these sites are for massage parlors. And you actually can learn quite a bit, and the data is systematized in a way that you could map it. You could map it by risk level, you could map it by client perceived ethnicity and age of the masseuse. So there's actually, you can develop all kinds of spatial models and regression models using this data. Plus there's tons of qualitative information because the users make extensive comments on their experiences. So, and some of that is actually the most fascinating. If we do this again, we actually hand-coded everything. If we do this again, we might hire a programmer to just try to pull down all the information, develop a database for us.
That's
so
interesting.
Yeah, there are so lots of new possibilities with the internet.
That's great.
Any other questions?
Before we leave, does everybody, did you get invited through our email? If you're not, please give us your, if you're the first time.
We have a sign-up sheet.
Excuse me?
We got a sign-up sheet.
Oh, you, great.
You,
yeah,
you
Alice got
you
it.
Put your name on it.
Oh, okay.
I have just one other final main question. Maybe getting back to, and this is actually asking you to kind of elaborate. I mean, you posed the question about balancing activists, scholarship, and you mentioned that your department was not very supportive of a project or something that you wanted to be involved in. And then Peter also mentioned being punished, right, mm-hmm, for your activist scholarship work. So I'm wondering if you didn't really elaborate on that. I'm wondering if you want to elaborate on what you feel are some of the tensions and maybe, you know, get mm-hmm some feedback or comments on that.
I appreciated Zai's comments about tenure track professors and needing to publish in a certain way, and but I guess I have a little bit of Peter's rebellious streak in me. I find journal publishing to be largely publishing for a very small group of people, and maybe only five or six people and who really know my, you know, that area will actually read the whole thing in depth. And so I've always been reluctant to spend, it can be an inordinate amount of time to do that kind of formatting.
Is there a disciplinary aspect to that? Because I know as planners, community engagement is kind of expected among practicing planners for sure. And in terms of the journals that we have to kind of publish our work, there isn't that immediate kind of dismissing of things that could be called kind of participatory action research, in which the researcher is actively engaged. So I'm wondering, is there a disciplinary?
I think so.
I think so, but there's also a question of whether those things count much when you go to counting for tenure and promotion in certain disciplines. So certain kinds of publications and certain kinds of journals don't count as much.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, my own experience was, you know, I published a nice book in an academic press, and then I published a whole series of articles in edited volumes where I thought, well, I would get a much broader read. But that's, mm-hmm, you know, that became, and then I was interested in moving into even more public scholarship. So these are just areas where I think it's very dicey,
right,
as an academic to take those risks. And I feel lucky that, you know, I got through the tenure process, but I feel lucky I did. I mean, I think the other piece is, I think a couple of people have mentioned that there's a part of giving back to the community, which is being responsive to people who ask questions. So when people from the press call, that's, I will spend an hour helping them do a background story, like the family that, were killed out in Queens. I mean, I never showed up in the article, but I spent an hour with that reporter talking about the background of Fujianese migration and that sort of thing. But and Brooke loves to put my citations on the website that I was in
it.
The Times or whatever, but I will get zero credit for that. Those hours of time of cultivating reporters and networks and connections. So I don't know. I don't think I'm going to change the system, but I think it's just tricky how we continue to navigate this.
Right.
I'm inspired by Peter being named a distinguished professor at CUNY. I'm shocked. Not because of Peter, but because of CUNY. He's really setting a marker out there around activist scholarship, and CUNY recognized that, and that's quite remarkable, and I think something that creates some space for all of us.
Mm-hmm. Can I add something? But I think that, to be relevant, you have to engage the reporters. You have to speak out. You have to write those articles. Because otherwise, what we're studying becomes like, who cares? But it's relevant for the everyday people we talk to, right? So we have to publicize it, and we have to talk to the reporters when they ask us, even if it's for a background story. Because I do that all the time, too. Every couple years, I feel like I get quoted. But you do it all the time, right? So you do it all the time. You give them the background stories. They go look for it. Hopefully one day they'll publicize you, or they'll give you contacts, too. And that's what I've learned. I always ask for contacts. So when the reporters call, I ask for who else are they talking to? Because can I call them too? I ask for that. You should do that. And then the other thing is just to be relevant, because those are the issues you want, our issues. You want what we're studying to be important, so that when our book comes out, that's out there too. So it's relevant, and people are interested in your book and in your work. So you should publicize it.
But I think Ken is talking about something a lot more tricky.
No, I understand what you're talking about.
So the point here is this. There is no disciplinary differences. But if you want to get published through an academic referee journal, you have to fulfill a certain format. That format is constantly quoting this, quoting that, right? So in the first page, it's already four quotes.
Well, you have to, you have to place in the literature.
You have to place in the literature, right.
So the point here is, that's fine. The only problem is my research, right, in fact, did not get any stuff from that literature. That's why I'm doing what I'm doing, right? So basically, the stuff that I find is my own research. Am I going to call myself? Right? Mm-hmm. I do sometimes. Yeah. But anyway, but the point I'm trying to say is there is also when you activist, it's not something that's it's organic things. They come to you because you spend so much time. You understand these things. Nobody else do this research. Yes, maybe I could quote you, but you haven't done that research, right? So this is where you get into a really problem. I mean, the referee journal says, how come you're not? I mean, the stuff that everybody says, Peter, where's the quote? Right? I said, well, this is my research.
No, it's where do you fit in the literature is what they ask.
That's how do you the big problem.
Yeah.
It's like, you have to fit within the conversation, the predominant conversation.
Right.
And if you're doing unique research,
right.
It doesn't fit within the prominent, predominant conversation.
So you, this is the problem.
You have to force it.
And so I have no advice for this other than, I publish a lot in academic literature. It's because somebody asked me to write a piece into an edited volume. That's why I mentioned to you very few referee journals, but rather the uniqueness of my writing, unique topics, that somebody would say, we're adding something. That's where my accumulation comes from. Mm-hmm. Giving interviews and all that, that doesn't count anything.
Right.
Yeah. So,
right.
Yeah. So I think this is where I drift. I drift from the historians, history professor wants it, or anthropology. Anthropology likes my stuff. So these are the things that's opportunity. It takes a long time. It's much more frustrating because you can't just say, I'm going to present this thing to a certain journal and automatically, you know, there's going to be problems.
Part of that has to do, I think, is not just with activism, but with the topic of Asian Americans.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So that if you write about
exactly
Asian Americans, it's not seen as talking about something universal. It's seen as like a niche kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So if you want to talk about gentrification, but it's about Asian Americans, then that's an Asian American article. It's not about gentrification.
Exactly.
Right. So that you sort of get marginalized because you're studying Asian American populations.
I had an article that went around in any number of journals, and it was always the question of, well, this is really interesting, but why would it be relevant to our larger audience?
That's right.
It's a nice piece on Chinatown, but we'd have to have a better title and a better framing so it speaks to a larger debate. And,
right. So one of the pushback I had is Asian American Studies UCLA wanted me to be a director years ago. And I went there. They said, well, no, you have to be affiliated to a department. There's no Asian American department. So the only one would be political science, mm-hmm. right? So I already finished a very well-received book, Chinatown Labor and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. So I met the dean. The dean says, you know, your work is interesting. Are they all facts? This is exactly what I'm saying, because I didn't quote enough people and all that stuff. I said, sure.
Believe me.
I mean, you know, okay. That I just ignore that. Then he says, you know, this is a political science department. Ethnic study is not part of the political science department.
Right.
We don't consider ethnic studies
right.
mm-hmm. properly belong
that
to
department.
Yeah.
Right.
So if you want to become part of this department, right, the only way you, meaning me, is I have to apply as a China expert, right, which was my time. But I'm the China expert. He says, we don't need another one. But what I'm trying to say is that the marginalization about you know, in other words, I'm not political science, I'm not Chinese scholars either, insofar as they're concerned, that this is where the real problems comes in. I mean, I think things are a lot better because a lot of people go through the regular departments coming through, but, you know, these...
Okay. Any final, yes?
Just a quick, if you don't mind, I guess just following on those questions and discussions that we had. I mean, another angle on the question of relevance, I mean, as some of you may know, I come from philosophy literature, so this question is very relevant. The relevance is always,
right.
in a way, because it's a bit harder for us to translate this invisible kind of, you know, intellectual work, render that, you know, into something that's more approachable, especially for students. And also the question of a self-referentiality of scholarly work, you know, that ends up really become viciously and kind of, you know, ironically, really just kind of self-consuming and self-promoting, etc. I think it's a really, I mean, we are really dwelling on this really important question that germane, I think, to really the question of scholarship in general, right, across the fields, but especially the whole notion of what it means to do research, right? And so, for instance, you know, when we fill out this annual, you know, kind of evaluation, you know, I'm a research active scholar, you know, we mm-hmm. say that, but I always ask, well, research active I am, but is my research active,
mm-hmm.
right? I mean, this is the question that we are asking, right? And so, for instance, what interests me is to really think about, in a very concrete way, is like, you know, say, how do I sort of evaluate myself apart from this rubric that we need to participate in order to, you know, sort of to be part of institutional conversations, right? So how do I know when I really fulfill something, right? So let's say as a teacher, as a philosophy teacher, I always find it very rewarding. If a student comes in and say, you know, I thought about that question, you know, the meaning of life, right? When they genuinely thought about it, right?
Nice.
Then it's really rewarding, right? It has an impact, mm-hmm. right? It's not my knowledge, but I'm simply a messenger of this, mm-hmm. you know, this really important but invisible labor, right? Undocumented scholarship,
right.
as it were, right? It's, mm-hmm. it's passing through us, right?
Nice.
And that's the kind of really the link that we are really trying to sort of also foster, right? And so, and it's interesting to think about that, you know, the what is our responsibility and how do I gauge that? How do I really put myself in that ethical relationship to what I produce, right? And so the feedback kind of that is really important. So it's like, well, so I've done something. Somebody is thinking about this question and struggling to write about it. So specifically my question is, say, apart from this question about the, you know, promotion and tenure, which is a result of what we produce. We are not doing it. We are not writing a book just because to, you know, in order to get, you know, but that's just something that comes after, right, as a result of our labor. There's something that really drives us, which is the really motivating mm-hmm. question, right?
Right?
So in relation to that bigger and very small question, what kind of impact do you think your scholarship, what you produce next, what you've been producing, what you've been putting out, what kind of things do you want to see? Do you want to see as a result of your scholarship? How would you like your research to be somehow be benefiting, right? The community that you're writing about. I mean, this is really an excellent point. It has really both ways. It's a question of trust, but also usability, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right? I'm not simply talking about how we need to translate this, you know, sort of that foreign language of a scholarship, right, into a language of the commoners, right? I mean, in a way they were thinking about it in terms of very kind of almost like a linguistic apartheid, right, they were living in, right? But it's just sort of literally the question of how do you know when you really made it, like in the sense that you, you know, what you have what you have produced as an impact, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's very hard for me to see as a philosophy professor and who was writing, you know, in various ways, like journals and, you know, philosopher's language, it's a foreign language, right, in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm curious about, because you're using a very concrete and empirically rooted and live data, right, and so you're actually producing something out of it, right,
mm-hmm.
and so that research really should have an immediate impact
mm-hmm.
in a very visible way, right?
Mm-hmm.
On
well,
people who are using it. So,
I mean,
what
yeah,
would be your
yeah, yes and no.
That?
I'd say yes and no,
mm-hmm.
because you know, I worked a lot for many years in providing direct services to communities,
mm-hmm.
and they actually know what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they don't.
Nice.
They don't necessarily need our research to figure out what to do. I think our research supports them. I think it helps inform or provide a theoretical framework for what they're doing,
mm-hmm.
sort of elevate it perhaps to
mm-hmm.
a different level. We can be critics of what they're doing. We can produce a foundation for credibility when they go to funders
mm-hmm.
to fund their research. And so a lot of times this collaboration is not because we're telling them what's
mm-hmm.
happening, it's we're documenting in a way that the powers that be could understand. The other thing I would say is sometimes we're uncovering stuff that nobody knows about. And so in that sense, sometimes a mark of success is just that now people know about it because
mm-hmm.
somebody studied it, maybe there was an article written about it. But a lot of times I have to say, like, even though my research is very applied and very empirical, that I sometimes feel like it sort of sits on a shelf. I think it spans the range.
Mm-hmm.
So in some ways our dilemma is not that far apart, I think, yeah.
Interesting.
Because we're a little out of over time,
yeah.
So thank you
sorry,
very much for the panelists, and thank you guys for coming and great conversation.